Question for you. How many places of worship do you think there are in this country? Really think about it, not too much. Take about 15 seconds and throw a wild guess out there and share it with the person to your right or to your left. Go for it. How many places of worship in the country? Go ahead, engage. Keep going. Seriously, it's too quiet. Throw a guess out there. Okay, that's enough time. I've had enough. According to the American Religion Data Archive's most recent survey, there are 250,402 places of worship in the United States of America. And I think that's probably a conservative number, because there are buildings here in our country that don't appear to be places of worship that in actuality are places of worship. There are buildings made of steel and glass all around us in Franklin. And tomorrow, thousands of people will pour into these buildings. They'll sit behind desks or offices or cubicles, and some will find their ultimate sense of purpose and identity and worth in that building. Some people will sacrifice in that building the best of their time, their emotional energy, their effort. Even their families will be sacrificed in that building. Oh, they won't know that's what's happening, but that's reality. It's not just a cube. It's not just a job site. It's not just a classroom. It's a sanctuary for some people. There's another building nearby where they have a big vault full of money. And some people go into that building, and their primary sense of security and safety comes from how much money they have in that vault. And they offer sacrifices in that building because, and this is on your notes, the God we worship is the one we sacrifice for. Make no mistake about it. The God we worship is the one we sacrifice for. There's another building not far from here, and the walls have floor-to-ceiling mirrors. And the priests and priestesses dress in spandex and leotards. People spend hours there sculpting their bodies and getting ripped. And we live in a crazy culture that values looking good over living a good life. And for some people, their temple might be a mall or a stadium or a school or a television studio. We're a worshiping people. It's who we are. It's what we do. We can't escape this reality. We worship. We all treasure something above anything else in our lives. We just do. You'll give your devotion to something or somebody, and you already have when you walked in here today. Your devotion is somewhere. In ancient Israel, the gods that rivaled the one true God were not called hobbies or addictions or habits. They were called idols. I was amazed this week as I was preparing this message that the Bible is a book full of idols. I want to share three of the most basic ones. The first one is Baal. He was a Canaanite god. It literally means master or lord. And the people back then believed that Baal was the one that ruled over the weather. And so he brought rain and storms, and he would produce crops for the people, and they would pray and ask him to do things. And then Molech was a real dark one. He was associated with infant sacrifice. The prophet Jeremiah says this to Israel about Molech. They built high places and sacrificed sons and daughters to Molech. That really happened. And then Dagon was the god of the Philistines. And you know the Philistines and Goliath. So there's another one of the primary gods. The idols they built back then were very large and expensive statues. Their size signified power and wealth and beauty and grandeur. And it would be in the form of a person or an animal to signify action. But in the ancient times, the people back then, the smart people back then, knew that that statue was not the actual God, that the God was invisible. They would have this inauguration ceremony where they would pray and they would dance and they would sing. And the idea was that at this ceremony, the idol, the statue, would be activated. The mouth would be open, the eyes would open, and the God would be online. It would be activated and they would be working. And they saw the statue as a way to manipulate spiritual powers to get what they wanted. They manipulated spiritual powers as a way to get what they wanted. The idol wasn't about giving devotion. It was about manipulation to get what you want. And the story we find ourselves in today, you're going to see one of these inauguration ceremonies where the people who had previously been redeemed from Egypt are worshiping a created idol, a statue of a golden calf, and they're seeking its activity, they're seeking its blessing, and they're looking for it to be animated and put online. Moses has just come down from Mount Sinai. He received the law, the Ten Commandments. He came down. He was glowing with the glory of God. The people were freaked out just a little bit about that. But Moses reassured them with these words in Exodus 20:20. Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning. That's a huge verse. The fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning. We're going to come back to that later. Very important. Moses goes back up the mountain to receive more instructions from God, and this time he's gone a long, long time, much longer than they ever anticipated. And instead of relying on God and putting their hope in God and treasuring God, they went back to Egypt in their hearts. This is what the Bible says. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, this is in Exodus 32, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him." Now, this is amazingly sad. Do you realize what caused these people to lean back into idolatry and go back to their default pagan mode? It was waiting. They didn't want to wait. Moses was gone, and they were wanting him to come back down. They don't know what's going on. And so instead of sitting in that pain, they let their anxiety get the best of them, and they went back to Egypt. False gods. Hurry and anxiety and fear and worry. The reason why those things are so toxic to the soul is because they lead us to false gods. They cause us to rely on things and treasure things that overpromise and underdeliver. These created beings, these idols we worship, only lead to more disappointment and more failure and more pain. Here's the deal about an idol. The idol is always on your timetable. Because the idea of an idol is that you worship it, you devote to it, so that it will get you what you want. But with the one true God, you're on his timetable. And it is impossible to manipulate God. God will get his will done with us or without us. And that's a harsh reality, but it's reality nonetheless. Aaron takes their gold jewelry, melts it down, and he creates a calf. Tomorrow there will be a festival, the text says. And the idea is that there's going to be a ceremony where the calf would get activated and come alive. Anybody here remember the first of the Ten Commandments? You shall have no other gods before me. You shall have no other gods before me. It's the prohibition of idolatry, and the people are already breaking the first of God's rules. Didn't take very much. This disobedience provoked a response from God. It does not go unnoticed. This is what the Bible says in verse 7. Go back down there, because your people whom you brought up out of Egypt have become corrupt. They've become quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, "These are the gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." Now, this calf is taking credit for what God did. It's insanity. I have seen these people, God says, and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them, that I may destroy them. That's in the Bible. God is furious. Moses begs God after this to have mercy and to relent, because the project of Israel is far from finished. And in a stunning turn of events, Moses persuades God to hold back. You think prayer is not powerful? This is not some special conversation in the ancient world. This was a dialogue between a person and God. And as far as I can tell, there was nothing any more spiritual or heroic or virtuous about Moses than there is about you or me. He just dared to believe that there was a God and that he might actually talk back to him. And they're talking, and God says, I'm going to wipe them off the face of the earth. Moses begs for mercy, and Moses got it. Moses goes back down there, and he sees his brother Aaron, who's leading the gold calf ceremony. And Aaron is just a little bit evasive about this. Verse 22, look at what Aaron says. Don't be angry. You know how prone these people are to evil. They said to me, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him. So I told them, whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off. They gave me the gold. I threw it into the fire, and boom, out came this calf. It sounds a lot like the blaming banter in Genesis when Adam and Eve were blaming each other about the fruit. It's the same thing. Blaming, accusing, denying. The golden triangle of sin. Just like that. Who would have guessed? Gold jewelry, boom, here comes a calf. We all want to avoid the appearance of idolatry. We hear the word idolatry, we think statues and ancient paganism. We don't do that anymore. But idolatry still exists. It's just a little bit sneakier. And before you know it, you are worshiping an idol and it's killing you. It happens to people all the time. Of course, the issue never was the statue. It's not the statue of Baal or of the golden calf. It's the internal heart condition that leads to this. The real problem is not a temple. It's not a statue. It's the false God that lives in my heart and competes with God. Here's how Tim Keller describes an idol. An idol is anything more important to you than God, anything that absorbs your heart and captivates your imagination more than God, anything you seek to give you what only God can give. Idolatry is something, and it's really sinister. It's when you take something and you put it in the place of God. And part of the problem with idolatry is you can take something that's good, that's actually a gift from God. Money, work, power, a hobby, a relationship. Those are good things, but when you make good things ultimate things, bad things happen. We become idolaters. When you give something other than God your ultimate devotion, when you put it at the center of your life where God exists, we become idol worshipers. And Paul described it like this in Romans 1. They've exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and they worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator. One of the problems of our day, and it's really serious, is that we don't think we have an idol until our idol gets threatened. Oh, and then bar the door. When our idol is threatened, the real us comes out. Here's a fundamental truth about idolatry. Prosperity and comfort masks our idols. Pain and crisis reveal them. When everything's going okay, I don't have an idol problem. So I think. But then crisis comes. Then I realize that maybe I've been relying on this false God the whole time. Pain shows us who we really are and what we're really made of. When we're squeezed, the real us comes out. John Calvin said that the human heart is an idol factory, and some would say in our nation. and more specifically this city, is an idol factory. They just may wear a religious and beautiful robe. I would tend to agree. The wrong question this morning is, do I worship idols? That's not the right question. The right question is, which idol is God's biggest rival in my life? We all struggle with this. I'm going to take a risk here. Hope you don't mind. I want to go to a deeper, more personal place. Look in your sermon notes under the title Idol Test. There are two parts to this. First, I would like for us to write down some idols that are commonly worshipped in our culture. So take a pen, and we're just going to go through this as they are, and then I'm going to ask some questions, and by the end of this test, you may discover which idol is the biggest rival in your life. On the first blank, write the word money. Just write down the word money. Does anybody here have any questions about whether money can be an idol? Paul makes this explicit. He warns the Colossians, therefore put to death, and he mentions all these sins. The last one he mentions is greed, the one we don't like to talk about that much around here. Greed. It is idolatry. Money always wants to be more than money. Number two, success. Another subversive, sneaky idol, but it's an idol. Upward mobility, moving up, getting ahead, being rewarded for your work, being noticed for your work. Number three, being smart. Again, who doesn't want to be smart? The alternative is not too desirable. You ever hear anybody brag about their degrees? Ever around somebody that always has to be the smartest person in the room? Paul said that knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Number four, attractiveness. We'll actually spend quite a lot of money, sometimes go through physical pain for this one. We cover our blemishes, we sculpt our bodies, paint our faces, and even go under the knife so people will take notice and notice how hot we are, how good looking we are. We're a funny people, aren't we? Number five, relationships. A relationship can be an idol. If I put it in the wrong place, if I put you in the wrong place, you put me in the wrong place. This unhealthy sense of attachment happens. And if a person has control of your emotional well-being, this is a real issue for you. When you exist for the approval of somebody else, in our day we call that codependency. In the Bible, they call it idolatry. Six, write down the word pleasure. When we orient our lives around self-gratification or getting a buzz, and that's generally about escaping reality and creating an alternative reality to live in because the real thing is too painful, rather than sit in the pain and walk through the pain trusting God, we push the eject button and we numb the pain. In our day, we call that an addiction. The Bible calls it idolatry. This also would include hobbies that we spend too much money on, we spend too much time on. If my marriage is being damaged, or if my children are being neglected because of a hobby I have, the check engine light in my soul is blinking at me. Number seven, church. You're like, whoa, church? Not an idol. Church is a good thing. You're right, but remember, many of these things are good things that we make ultimate things. When church is an idol, you got to be careful with this. When we want to cultivate a reputation for being spiritual or knowing the Bible, those desires can become false gods. When image management becomes my core passion, and I want to be thought of as a certain way, then I project this false, phony image of this hyper-spiritual guy that's just not real. And Jesus railed against this. This is not just, well, he's a crazy, kooky Jesus guy. It's hypocrisy. It's Pharisaical religion, and it breeds nothing but death. Jesus said this is awful stuff, and it can really hinder our relationship with God. The last one is work. People trash their lives worshiping at this altar. And when we confuse what we do with who we are, this is an idol. All right, let's go deeper. You ready? I'm going to ask you some questions. And after each of these questions, I want you to put a check mark beside one of those on the list that fits the criteria. It's going to be a diagnostic for each of us. And I'm not going to ask you to share the results with the person to your right or left. Don't worry about that. This is between you and God. The courageous will take this to their home groups and say, I've got an idol problem. Some of you will choose to stay in hiding and let this go under the radar for longer, and the idol will just rip your life apart even more. So we're going to keep it real here. Is that cool? All right, number one, get your check mark ready. Which of these do I find myself thinking about the most? Put a check mark by it. Look over the list. Which one of these occupies your mind? We daydream about our idols. We just think about them a lot. Number two, which one of these do you most fear losing? Or feel like life might not be worth living if I don't have this, if I lost it? Which one of these things tempts you to feel that way? Put a check mark by it. Number three, which of these idols most gives me a sense of identity? Which one of these makes me feel like I'm somebody? Number four, which of these do I most look to make me feel secure? Which one are you most tempted to gain a sense of security from? Put a check mark by it. Which of these do I most want to be known for? That's the fifth question. Look down the list. Scan the list. Which one do you want to be known for? Number six, which of these idols causes your emotions to fluctuate the most, to go up and down? What makes me happiest when I have lots of it, and what makes me saddest when I don't have much of it and it's threatened? Put a check mark by it. Which one would other people who know me well say is my idol? Your spouse, your friends, your parents, your siblings, the people who really know, and they've seen your dark underbelly, if you know what I mean. They know who you are. Which one of these would they say is your idol? Finally, of these eight, which one do my efforts most tend to revolve around? Because we give our behavior, our actions, our ultimate priority. Which one of these do I sacrifice for? Okay, so look at your list. Which one of these has the most check marks by it? Don't say it out loud. My friend, that's the primary rival of God in your life. That's it. We all have it. I want to read the rest of Exodus 32. And I want you to see how God responds to their idolatry. Exodus 32, 25. Moses saw that the people were running wild and that Aaron had let them get out of control. And so they became a laughingstock to their enemies. So he stood at the entrance to the camp and said, "Whoever is for the Lord, come to me." And all the Levites rallied to him. Then he said, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Each man strap a sword to his side. Go back and forth through the camp from one end to the other, killing his brother and friend and neighbor." The Levites did as Moses commanded, and that day about 3,000 of the people died. Then Moses said, "You have been set apart to the Lord today, for you were against your own sons and brothers, and he has blessed you this day." The Levites were the only ones who didn't cave. The next day Moses said to the people, "You have committed a great sin. But now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." So Moses went back to the Lord and said, "Oh, what a great sin these people have committed. They have made themselves gods of gold. But now please forgive their sin. But if not, then blot me out of the book you've written." That's the heart of an intercessor right there. That's extreme love for a people. If you're not going to save them, send me to hell too. That's what he's saying. Verse 33, "Then the Lord replied to Moses, 'Whoever has sinned against me, I will blot out of my book. Now go lead the people to the place I spoke of, and my angel will go before you. However, when the time comes for me to punish, I will punish them for their sin.' And the Lord struck the people with a plague because of what they did with the calf Aaron had made." What's God saying to you? And what are you going to do about it? As much as I want to relieve the tension this part of the story may create for you, I can't do that in good conscience. It says what it says. The bottom line is that their disobedience aroused God's anger. It disappointed him, and it broke his heart. It made him so furious that he wanted to end the story right then and there with one swift, bold, violent move against them. Rather than soften this reality and make it all better, I want us to just sit with this. And I want us to create a sacred space for us to be with God, just here now. I know silence can be awkward, but I don't care. Let's be silent for a few seconds together. And I would encourage you to ask God, "What are you saying? And what am I to do with this?" We're going to enter a time of communion now. Go ahead and pass out the communion elements. Just hold them when you get them. While you take the bread and the juice, I want to talk to you very briefly about two costs of idolatry. Worshipping an idol will cost you God's purpose for your life. If I embrace the one true living God, then he gets to set the agenda for my life. I don't. God has a purpose for me. He is deeply concerned about me. And he has created a path for me to walk on. It's a good path. It's a life-giving path. the idols I worship, they overpromise and they underdeliver. I was made to worship and follow God. That's my core purpose. Before I'm a husband or a father or a minister or a friend or a brother, I'm a child of God, created to worship God. Another cost of idolatry is idol worship will exhaust you. Idols take you to places you never thought you'd go. It'll cost you things you never thought you'd have to pay. And the result of long-term idol worship is pain and fatigue. Not just fatigue in your body, but fatigue in your soul. Tired, worn out, frayed, ripped apart. You pursue an idol long enough, it'll kill you. But letting the idols go and giving yourself wholly to God leads to deep satisfaction. Psalm 16:11 says, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." That's God. Jesus is still inviting people to give up their idols and follow him. Jesus alone is worthy of my full devotion. He alone has the authority to forgive my idolatry. And he alone has the power to take a cold, hardened, twisted, diseased, idol-worshiping heart and make it soft and responsive and tender and loving to God. Only Jesus can do that. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took some bread and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Whenever you eat this, remember me." Let me rephrase what he said. Whenever you eat this, remember how much your idolatry costed me. It cost the blood of the eternal Son of God, the second person of the Trinity. And he took it. Let's eat the bread together. In a similar fashion, he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant." It's a covenant that God forged with an idol-worshiping people. A people who are prone to spiritual adultery, cheating on God with this and that God. And instead of discarding us and divorcing us, he keeps coming for us in the person of Jesus, saying, "Give up the idols, release your worries, and trust me, let's drink the cup together." Close by reading a prayer that David wrote in Psalm 86 about giving your whole heart to God. Pray this with me, okay? "You are forgiving and good, O Lord, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. In the day of my trouble, I call to you, for you will answer me. Among the false gods, There is none like you, O Lord. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, O God. They will bring glory to your name. For you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever, for great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the depths of the grave. Father, you know the truth about us. We live in a culture that is saturated with idolatry. We live in a culture that celebrates idolatry. Our hearts are idol factories, and we are all guilty. There is none who are righteous, not even one, the word says. Lord, we confess to you that we worship idols not because we're mildly defective or dysfunctional. We worship idols because we don't fear you. Would you put the fear of God in us to keep us from sinning? As best we can, here and now, we lay our idols before you. We kneel at your feet. We surrender to you. We want to offer you our full devotion, our adoration, our worship. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen.